Remember the 5th of November, of gunfire, treason, and plots. I know of no reason why gunpowder treason should ever be forgot. Hello, and welcome back to Jenna Gets Creative, and today we're going to talk about the 5th of November, also known as Bonfire Night here locally in Newfoundland. So let's get drawing and chatting.
The 5th of November is known as Guy Fawkes Night or Bonfire Night in many places around the world, but why is that? Today I'm drawing a Guy Fawkes mask, and I'd like to talk to you about the history of Guy Fawkes Night, who Guy Fawkes was, and what the traditions are here where I live. But first, if you're new here, don't forget to subscribe and ring the bell for notifications. YouTube has changed how that bell works, so if you want all notifications, click it again and make sure it's filled in all the way. I'm an art channel, and I upload twice a week at minimum, every Tuesday and Thursday. I also do bonus videos from time to time, including the third Friday of every month, which is the official Art Addicts Alliance upload day. If you're an art channel with at least 100 subscribers and you're interested in joining, or if you have less and you'd like to be an official guest, check out the info in the description on my last Art Addicts Alliance video. We do currently have a few spots open. Don't worry if you don't hear back from us right away, though. We require votes from all members to make these decisions, and a couple members are quite busy lately. And of course, as always, if you like this video, don't forget to hit like and leave a comment down below. I love reading your comments, and I do reply to everyone. If you have Guy Fawkes Night or Bonfire Night traditions, tell me about them in the comments down below. I'm also curious to hear from people who don't have this holiday. If this video is the first you're hearing of it, let's talk about it. Of course, you might recognize the poem from the film V for Vendetta, and you've probably seen the mask in videos from the group known as Anonymous. The history I'm about to discuss is where it all comes from. In 1605, there was an attempted assassination of King James I by a group of 13 individuals, including but not led by Guy Fawkes. This was known as the Gunpowder Plot. The poem I recited in the intro is the first six lines of a longer poem about this night. It's called The 5th of November, and it's an English folk verse with a lot of variations, but those first six lines are perhaps the most recognized around the world. The 5th of November 1605 was the state opening of Parliament, and the group planned to blow up the House of Lords during the opening. The primary target was to kill King James I, but they chose the opening of Parliament because it would make several other targets vulnerable all at once. Many of the king's relatives and the Privy Council would be in attendance, much of the Protestant aristocracy, many senior judges, bishops of the Church of England, and, of course, all of the other members of the House of Lords and House of Commons. They also planned to kidnap the Princess, Elizabeth. This was because they could use her to control the course of politics in England by declaring her king when everyone else ahead of her in line, her father, the king, and her brothers, were dead. And because she was only 9 years old, they would install a regent to rule in her place whom they could control. This was meant to be Henry Percy, 9th Earl of Northumberland, who wasn't in on the plot and had no idea. Revolts in the Midlands were planned to start around the same time. If you couldn't tell by now, this was a religiously fueled plot. The Church of England was law at this time, and Catholics were being persecuted. This is just one of many times in England's history, and indeed the UK's history more broadly, that major conflicts have arisen based on Anglican versus Catholic ideals and vying for power. Fawkes was going to be the one to light the fuse on the barrels of gunpowder beneath Parliament that night. He would escape across the Thames and later leave for the continent. Revolts in the Midlands were to start at the same time as the explosion. This and the rest of the plan were finalized the month before during a series of tavern meetings in October. There were lots of doubts, however, both among those involved in the plot and among their wives, and several of these individuals considered warning people not to attend Parliament. A letter was delivered during a supper party at the house of Lord Monteagle on the 26th of October, which read, "My Lord, out of the love I bear to some of your friends, I have a care for your preservation. Therefore, I would advise you, as you tender your life, to devise some excuse to shift your attendance at this Parliament. For God and man hath occurred to punish the wicked of this time. and think not slightly of this advertisement, but retire yourself into your country, where you may expect the event in safety. For though there be no appearance of any stir, yet I say they shall receive a terrible blow this Parliament, and yet they shall not see who hurts them. This council is not to be condemned, because it may do you good and can do you no harm. For the danger is past as soon as you have burnt this letter, and I hope God will give you the grace to make good of it, to whose holy protection I commend you. Of course, Lord Monteagle didn't burn the anonymous letter as instructed. He shared it with the Earl of Salisbury, who shared it with the Earl of Worcester, and with the first Earl of Northumberland, but notably not with the king himself. The plotters knew immediately of the letter, but decided to wait and see what would happen, rather than cancelling the plot altogether. On the 1st of November, the letter was finally shown to King James I. Lord Chamberlain Thomas Howard, 1st Earl of Suffolk, was instructed to search both above and below the Houses of Parliament. Meanwhile, the plotters met for the final time on the 3rd of November and decided to continue. They planned to abduct Elizabeth on the 4th, a task assigned to participant Digby, who would conveniently be part of a hunting party at Dunchurch. Participant Percy visited the Earl of Northumberland to see if he could discern what was being done about the letter Lord Monteagle had received, and returned convinced that nothing had been done that would disturb the plot. Several plotters departed for the Midlands. As the king's men searched above and below Parliament as instructed, they first discovered what they thought was a humble serving man guarding a load of firewood. This was Fox, in disguise, and he informed the men that the firewood belonged to his master, Lord Percy. This name sent up red flags, and the men were sent back to investigate further. This time, when they found Fox, he was dressed in a hat, a cloak, boots, and spurs. He gave the name John Johnson when he was arrested, and he was searched for belongings. He had a lantern, a pocket watch, touchwood, and several slow-burning matches. The king's men then searched the area more and found 36 barrels of gunpowder hidden under the wood and coal. News of John Johnson's arrest spread, and Fox was brought before the king on the morning of the 5th of November. The rest of the plotters were convinced that they could still start an uprising and an armed revolt, and six of them went on to meet with the hunting party at Dunchurch to convince them that the king and the Earl of Salisbury were dead. Meanwhile, although John Johnson was unwilling to reveal any information while he was being interrogated, a letter addressed to Guy Fawkes was found on his person. He then admitted that he had been planning to light the barrels, but insisted that Guy Fawkes was an alias and that he had acted alone. The king was impressed by Fox's stubbornness and described him as having a Roman's resolution. Fox slash Johnson and the barrels of gunpowder were moved to the Tower of London on the 6th of November, where Johnson would be tortured. Several others investigating for the king questioned servants in key households and discovered the names of several plotters, but Fox denied their participation. Johnson, aka Fox, resisted torture on the 6th and held firm that he had acted alone, but on the 7th he broke and confessed the truth, which he confirmed during continued torture on the 8th and 9th. Over the course of those early days after Johnson's arrest, the other plotters were identified and killed, either on site or later during public executions. For many years following the gunpowder plot, the night was commemorated on its anniversary by the ringing of church bells, special sermons in Anglican churches, and various other public events. An act was passed in Parliament on January 1606 called the Observance of the 5th of November Act, and this act was in place until 1859. Bonfires became a traditional observance in England, and among the eastern colonies, fireworks displays were organized. Because of this, Guy Fawkes Night was also commonly known as Bonfire Night, or Fireworks Night in England and across the world. In England, bonfires and fireworks displays on the 5th are still common, and in the week leading up to Bonfire Night, you might see figures known as guys made by children from old clothing stuffed with newspaper and straw. These guys are exhibited in the streets as fundraising to purchase fireworks. Although this practice is less common now, it was very common in the 19th century, and thus guy became a colloquial term to refer to a person who was dressed oddly, and transformed in the 20th century to the more general use of a male person. In modern times, some parts of the world still celebrate Bonfire Night, though not everyone knows why it's celebrated. Here in Newfoundland, Bonfire Night is very common, which surprised me when I moved here from British Columbia, but I never hear people talking about why it's celebrated or see any guys done up at all. It's just an excuse to stand around a bonfire with family and friends, drink hot chocolate or more adult beverages, and watch some fireworks. When I was growing up in BC, some family friends who were very proud of their British heritage combined Bonfire Night with Halloween. Every year, in preparation for Halloween, Mr. Foster would make up a stuffed guy, which I always thought was just another scarecrow, and for some strange reason he named it Guy, and he gave it a jack-o'-lantern head. We would all go trick-or-treating around the subdivision with his sons, who were my age and 2 years older, and then all of our neighbors would gather in the empty lot beside their house. We all shared hot chocolate, the kids played with sparklers, Mr. Foster and the other dads set off fireworks, and then as the night wrapped up, Mr. Foster would burn the guy in a trash can fire. I didn't understand the reason or significance of this until many years later when I was studying history in university, and I didn't know Guy Fawkes Night was still a tradition anywhere else outside of England itself until I moved to Newfoundland and discovered a thriving Bonfire Night tradition. What about you? Do you have Bonfire Night? Did you even know about this? Let me know in the comments down below, and I'll see you on Thursday. Bye, guys.